In this video lecture, we'll start to examine the details of creating and manipulating 1D arrays in programs. Okay, let's get started. If you'll recall from prior materials on creating our own classes, we talked about a concept in programming called CRUD. Create, read, update, and delete. We're going to borrow from this idea again to organize some basic concepts needed for working with arrays. In terms of create, we're going to need to be able to declare, instantiate, and initialize new arrays. In terms of read, we're going to want to be able to access individual array elements, or to loop through or print the entire contents of an array. In terms of update, we're going to need to be able to modify individual array elements, or all the elements of an array, using a for loop. And in terms of delete, well, we're not going to concern ourselves with that in our discussions. As we go through the material that follows, note that all of the source code examples shown can be found in the file array1damples.java, found in the usual place. This will be an extremely useful collection of all fundamental array capabilities, so I would strongly encourage you to examine that file in JGRASP and view its accompanying code walkthrough video as you move through all the examples which follow in this lecture material. Ultimately, under the hood, arrays are implemented as objects, similar to what we've seen for strings or any other type of objects. Here are the three steps we need to perform to create a usable array. First, we need to declare an array, which is just a statement that some array is about to exist. Declaring an array results in an array reference, which is analogous to a string reference or a general object reference. Second, we need to instantiate an array, which is where we specify how large we want our array to be, an appropriately sized chunk of memory is allocated for our array, and initial default values are assigned to each of the array elements. This is similar to what happens when we create a new object using the new keyword and calling one of the object's constructors. Finally, we need to initialize the array, or assign specific values to the array elements, which might differ from their default initial values. Let's take a look at each of these steps in more detail. Here's the general form of declaring some array. We specify the array's data type, followed by opening and closing square brackets, followed by the desired array name. In particular, note that these are square brackets, not curly braces or parentheses, which are both common errors when setting up arrays. Also, those brackets are effectively an extension of the data type and indicate that it's an array of that data type. For example, an int array or a double array. Here on the right are some examples of array declarations. This first one is an int array called testScores. The second one is a double array called dailyTemps. And on this last line, ages is an int array, and so is itemCounts, because it's okay to declare multiple arrays on the same line, just like for any type of simple variable declarations. When we declare this first int array testScores, what we wind up with at this point is simply an array reference, as shown down here. This is nothing but a pointer to some unknown place in memory that hasn't been established yet. We don't know where the array will be stored or how big it will be yet. All we know at this point is that coming soon will be some array of integer values. This is directly analogous to what we've already seen for an object reference or string reference. This is all that exists so far after executing this first array declaration statement. In the second step, here is the general form of instantiating an array. We've already declared this array called ArrayName. Now we're performing some actual memory allocation using the new keyword, a data type, and the desired number of array elements. This memory size can be any integer constant or expression, or it can be dynamically established from some method or constructor argument, or calculated at runtime. So in this code example, here at the top, we've got some declared constants and variable values. This next part is simply a repeat of the previous array declarations. Then in this last part, we're actually bringing all these arrays into being by instantiating them and specifying exactly what size we want them to be. For example, here we're saying that we want the compiler to set aside enough room to store 5 ints, or 10 doubles, or 10 ints. Notice that we're using a constant, a literal value, and a variable to make these allocations. In this last example, we can even use an expression that evaluates to an int. So here, this entire term evaluates to 200, and memory for a 200-sized int array will be set aside. As a final operation, default values are automatically assigned to all of the array elements, We'll see what these defaults are on the next slide, and typically we'll want to override these defaults with our own specific values. So in this first example above, after we declare the int array test scores and instantiate it to 5 elements using the size constant, this is what our array will look like in memory. We have this array reference. It's now pointing to enough memory to hold 5 int values, which are all initialized to 0 for starters. This table shows the default values for all array elements upon instantiation. Integer data types are initialized to 0, floating point data types are initialized to 0.0, char data types are initialized to the null character, Boolean data types are initialized to false, and all object reference types are initialized to a null value. Does this table look familiar? Well, it should, because these default values are exactly the same ones used as defaults for the instance variables of any class. Just as we've seen before for both simple variables and objects, arrays too can be both declared and instantiated in one single operation, and this is perhaps more typical and certainly more convenient. Just keep in mind that there are really two separate and distinct operations involved, declaration and instantiation. So in this example here, we're declaring an int array called sumData, and remember that the square brackets are part of that declaration and indicate an array. Then we use the new keyword to instantiate the array and direct the compiler to set aside enough contiguous memory to hold this many elements of this data type, or in our case, 5 int values. Same as we saw before, here's what our memory will look like conceptually after executing that combined statement. Once again, we see that all our array elements are initialized to 0 by default. Let's next see how to initialize these values to the ones that we really want. Generally speaking, there are 3 different ways of initializing the values of an array. If all the array elements are to be set to some constant value or can be expressed algorithmically in some equation, we can use a for loop for initialization. In this top example, we're setting all 5 elements of the test scores array to 50, using a for loop and looping from I equals 0 up to I equals 4. Here, the loop index variable I has local loop scope, so we can use it to set each ith array element to 50. This left-hand side term, test scores sub I, simply represents the ith element of the array, and is itself equal to that one specific indexed array element. On the other hand, if the elements of our array are somewhat random or specific and can't be expressed algorithmically, we can set each array element specifically to some value. Here, we use the index of each array element, beginning at 0, and set each array element to some specified value. When we are finished, our initialized array will look like this in memory. Finally, there's one other way to initialize an array, and that's by using an initialization list. As we see in this last example, we declare an array of doubles on the left-hand side, then set its elements to this comma-separated list of double values within curly braces. The only catch here is that we can only do it this way at the time the array is declared, and not later on. In other words, we can't reset these values like this at some later point in time. The nice thing about this approach is that notice we don't use the new keyword or need any explicit array size. Instead, the array gets auto-initialized according to the number of data values provided. So if we know all our array values up front, this can be a nice shortcut way to go. Otherwise, if our array elements have some random values or we only need to initialize certain elements, this might be the way to go. But if we can express all our array elements using some equation or method call, this top way is definitely the preferred way to initialize an array. The nice thing about this for looping approach is that it scales to any number of array elements. Whether our array has 5 elements or 5,000, we can initialize it either way using just these 3 lines. Whenever we want to access specific array elements, we use their numeric index position within the array, just as we did for strings. The size of an array is given by the length parameter, which is automatically available to us for any array, and is a read-only integer instance variable of the array. This is a little different than for strings, because now length is a numerical parameter as opposed to a method call length. And this is a common point of confusion when using arrays. Also, when we want to access a specific element of an array, We do so using the square bracket notation, not parentheses or curly braces. Just like for a string, because arrays too are zero based, the first element of an array is the zeroth element, any generic array element is the ith element, and the last array element is the length minus 1 index. Also similar to strings, if you try to access non-existent array elements outside these bounds, you'll receive a runtime exception error of this type. The important thing to keep in mind about arrays is that each individual element is nothing but a single variable or object of that particular array's data type. So if array name is an array of ints, this entire expression represents one int value. If array name is an array of person objects, then this entire expression represents one person object. Such array elements, whatever their data type, can be written to, read from, or calculated with just as if they were one single variable or object of that particular data type. So in this first code example, this is how we would access the first element and the last element of the array new data. Again, note that the array index is contained within square brackets, and here length is a numeric parameter and not a method call. Because each array element is simply one scalar value of its particular data type, we can read and write to and from individual array elements just as we would any other variable or object of their particular data type. So in this bottom example, new data is an array of doubles, which means that each left-hand side term is itself one double variable, and we can assign them values, increment a value by 20, assign to it some other array elements, or assign to it the resultant value of some right-hand side of calculation, as we see in this last line. Finally, we said earlier that arrays and for loops are tightly coupled. Traversing an array simply means doing something with or to every element of the array using a for loop. So as we see in this top simple example, the first array index is always 0, the last array index is array name.length minus 1, so we perform looping up to but not including the array name.length element, which is represented by this less than relational operator. Here, we're initializing all the array elements using this simple expression involving the loop index to count up by tens from 10. Also, the loop index has local scope within the for loop, so we can use it in any array calculations or display. So in this last example, we're simply traversing the entire array and printing out a label which incorporates the array element index, giving us this output display on the left, along with the actual array element value itself, giving us this output display on the right for the array initialized above. Be careful of this common gotcha when traversing an array. Use length without parens to refer to the length, rather than using a method call as we do for strings. Okay, so these represent all the basic mechanics of setting up, initializing, and traversing any array. Next, we'll look at a long series of examples putting arrays to use on very common standard applications.